Hello, everyone. Welcome to our roundtable discussion on data's role in preventing the next pandemic. I'm Jennifer Nuzzo, and I'm very pleased to be presiding over this conversation. As we enter the third year of the COVID-19 pandemic, questions about our future are reaching a fever pitch. Policymakers, practitioners, and the general public want to know, of course, when the pandemic will end, whether and how to lift mandatory public health mitigation measures, like mask mandates, whether to require boosters, and when the next variant will emerge, whether that will erode all of our progress to date. It's not just the public sector, the private sector also has questions. Pandemic-related supply chain disruptions and travel restrictions are challenging business operations. Employees and want to know when they will go back to the office and whether they'll be called back. They also want to know whether policy measures like school interruptions will hinder their ability to show up to do their jobs. So the answer to all these questions require data. But for much of the pandemic, including now, we've not had adequate information to answer these and many other questions about how best to protect people and support society. So today's discussion is going to be about these data and how we get the information we need to answer the most pressing questions during a pandemic and also to prevent the next one from happening. It's not just the ongoing COVID-19 crisis, but we also need data to alert us to potential future pandemic threats. And to walk us through these issues, we're fortunate to be joined by someone who spent his entire career thinking about the data and evidence we need in public health emergencies. Rick Bright currently serves as the CEO of Pandemic Prevention Institute and Senior Vice President for Pandemic Prevention and Response, both at the Rockefeller Foundation. Dr. Bright has held senior positions both inside and outside of the US government to address emerging infectious diseases like the 2009 H1N1 pandemic, MERS, Ebola, Zika, and now COVID-19. And now at the Rockefeller Foundation, Dr. Bright is leading the newly formed Pandemic Prevention Institute, where he's working to develop a pandemic data and action platform that aims to prevent future pandemics by identifying and responding to the earliest alerts of disease outbreaks and stopping it in the first 100 days, a very bold vision. So he has a lot to tell us, and I'm very eager to learn from him in terms of what we need to do and what data we need and how we can get those data. So Rick, I'll turn it over to you. How can data make us safer against pandemics?
Jennifer, thank you very much. And I'm grateful for the Council on Foreign Relations for inviting me to join today's discussion. And Jennifer, in your introduction, I mean, I think it's important to note all the important work that you've done and others have done as well. It's such a pleasure to be here with you and to have followed such practical scientific guidance that you provided around testing and vaccines and other public health measures throughout this pandemic. So it's an honor to be here with you. And it goes without saying, and I don't think we have to overemphasize too much among this group, that the last 2 years have dealt the world a traumatic blow. We will never be able to fully enumerate the public health, life, economic, educational, and societal loss that we've experienced in the last 2 years and counting. And we all know that this pandemic will not be our last one and may not even be the worst one that we will face. So considering how our response to this pandemic is going to shape the future of health and health delivery and health innovation, there is one secret weapon that has helped us address every other outbreak in the past over many, many decades. It's not masks, it's not social distancing or lockdowns or even vaccines. It really is data, the data behind these decisions. And I believe that when data are tied to action and they can drive appropriate, nuanced mitigation around the world, then there is an economic upside to sharing this information and knowledge. And currently, as we know, governments, businesses, and individuals don't have the information they need to accurately and timely assess their risk. And this uncertainty is not only bad for society and health, it's bad for business. So data are what allows us to move from a panic-driven response that we've seen repeatedly in the last 2 years to a more science-driven response with more evidence-based policies. Throughout this pandemic, we've seen huge gaps in quality and consistency of data. The data have been maintained in silos. They've been slow to generate and share, and they've been controlled by state and nation actors. Limited access to and use of data have allowed us, or actually left us, slow to prepare and respond to the outbreak, and the variants that we've seen emerge and spread around the world so rapidly. While we've learned several hard lessons on how to contain and mitigate disease spread, each new variant of SARS-CoV-2 has reinforced a simple truth. We are not prepared. And Omicron is just the latest example. Using Omicron as an example, the Center for Epidemic Research and Innovation, or CERI, in South Africa, along with genomic epidemiologists in Botswana, played a pivotal role in first detecting the Omicron variant. Once validated, the scientists at CERI rapidly mobilized to notify the South African Ministry of Health and the World Health Organization. And it was only a matter of days, a few days, before the world was alerted to this new variant of concern. And interestingly, the genetic sequences had already been shared into a global database to give scientists around the world a heads up that something new was emerging. The world, this work, I would say, quickly enabled us to prepare our, get additional information and prepare our outlook on vaccines, on transmissibility of the virus. But what was the ultimate response to the South Africans sharing that data? It was a punitive knee-jerk policy on travel ban against multiple countries in Southern Africa, many where the variant had not even been detected. And these bans, that short-sighted as they were, limited access to needed reagents for continued research and medical countermeasures needed to save lives. Travel bans enacted without data or an evidence-based policy lead to division and fear. They politicize public health measures, they damage fragile economies, and they prevent global coordination while eroding trust that is so critical for our response. So as we move forward from this pandemic, innovation in data collection, data sharing, and data analytics and usage will shape the future of healthcare and our pandemic preparedness. This is what we're building at the Pandemic Prevention Institute, the Rockefeller Foundation. And to ensure success, there must be trust, collaboration, and data sharing. We've seen examples of this already because scientists around the world have shared over 8 million SARS-CoV-2 sequences into the GISAID community. The sequences we know don't tell us the full story. Less than 3% of all cases have been sequenced globally in the past year, with huge disparities around the world. 5.5% of those sequences from high-income countries and less than 0.4% in lower middle-income countries. And while over 190 countries and territories have submitted sequences to GISAID, 51 of these haven't submitted any sequence in the last year. So this highlights a lot of work that we need to do to ensure diversity and broader representation of the data that we need to evaluate and inform our decisions to guide us through the pandemic. For higher income countries making up 16% of the population, but 92% of all sequences shared to guide the pandemic. And it's not just outside the United States. It's important to note that even in the United States, diversity in sampling and data is absolutely lacking. So with this in mind, we launched a series of genomic sequencing accelerator hubs in the US to focus on expanding community representation of the data that we are collecting. And we are proud to partner with Louisiana State University, and they collaborated with Grambling University, a historically Black university. And scientists at Grambling were quick to grab to the technology jump and submitted their first sequence in the GISAID in September of 2021. And they're expanding rapidly on this progress today. And throughout the pandemic, it's become quite clear that relying solely on clinical samples and the types of data that we're so used to traditionally still limit the knowledge of what we need to know to get in front of a pandemic and prevent a future one. We need earlier signals, and we believe that some of those earlier signals are coming from environmental sampling, such as wastewater. We've already shown that environmental sampling and wastewater can be a critical data source for monitoring community-level trends of viral concentration, allowing us to detect virus in the community 2 to 3 weeks before a clinical sample is confirmed. And around the world, over 50 countries now are using wastewater to test for SARS-CoV-2. These data are critical to ramp up supplies and resources in these high-risk areas. They can be used to inform our healthcare system to better prepare our hospitals, to ensure they have adequate human resources and medicines and oxygen and ventilators for an impending surge in their community. And wastewater data can not only inform us about an impending surge, it's really important to know when the prevalence of a virus might be waning or diminishing in a community, so we can know when to dial back and modify and nuance in those communities our public health measures. So it's not a one-size-fits-all, light switch, mask on, mask off. It really is important to look at local data and look at the nuance associated with those data in that community to guide and have evidence-based policies on our public health mitigation measures. And of course, we also realize that genomic data is at the tip of the iceberg when it comes to a global platform to detect early signals for an impending outbreak. We have to look at data from other sources as well and combine it in new ways with our health and genomic data. So we're looking at mobility data, atmospheric data, consumerism, and social data in new ways, alone and in combination with our traditional public health data. It's also important to borrow and converge techniques from other sectors, such as the financial industry, believe it or not, where we're looking at modern data analytics and how they're used to assess risk in the financial markets, and learning from those algorithms and how we can bring those tools and that vision into the field of public health as we scout for these signals. And similar to a weather forecast, we need a platform, a common platform that can combine data and signals from data to give us a clear picture of what might be coming our way. And the data are useless if they're not shared. They need to be shared quickly, publicly, and globally. And equally so, the information must be translated into action and communicated in a way so everyone can understand it. You shouldn't have to have a PhD in bioinformatics or immunology or epidemiology to understand the risk around you. It is incumbent upon us as experts to be able to translate and communicate in a way so that everyone everywhere can understand the risk and understand what they need to do to mitigate that risk in their community. These are what I believe will get us closer to a world that is free of pandemics. I believe we have to do everything within our power to bring this about so we can say never again. However, to be successful, we must rely on political will and effective collaboration with multinational organizations like the WHO and their new Centers for Epidemic Intelligence, the CDC, and other entities around the world who are now investing in data and data analytics. We must find a way to combine these efforts and bring them all together in a new ecosystem. So we're not competing, we're not contrasting, but we are collaborating to get the most and best information available as quickly as possible. And the information and access to that information must be equitable. We must have equitable access and local ownership of the tools and data. We cannot think that data and information can or must be centralized in high-income countries and that governments alone can make determinations on what is important and when data are to be shared. We must build a local knowledge economy to enable and empower scientists, public health officials, and individuals with the information they need to be the first responder in their family or in their community. We must work together. No one entity or no one group or one person can do this alone. We must play to our strengths and contribute to the overall whole to create a global surveillance intelligence system that works for everyone and is not something held by just a few. I believe this is the foundation for a strengthened ecosystem that will allow us to see early signals, speed the response, and stop outbreaks as quickly as possible. Thank you. Jennifer, back to you.
Thank you so much for that, Rick. I really appreciate your vision. I mean, I think it's bold, it's ambitious, but it's also quite pragmatic. I mean, it just really describes, I think, a doable future were we to marshal the resources and the will. We're going to turn to questions, and I'm sure lots of folks have questions. And so I would encourage at this point, everyone to kind of put your hands up, maybe turn it back to, well, before I turn it back to Christina to just kind of remind us about that process, may take the liberties of just asking a few conversations, but in the meantime, people can start queuing with their hands up to get into the question list. I have so much to ask you, but maybe I'll start with what you said sort of at the onset of your remarks. And you talked about how we'll never be able to fully enumerate COVID's many tolls. It's interesting, in response to this pandemic, it's sort of what we saw, the rise of dashboards and the rise of data, and it perhaps maybe gave the impression that we've got all the data and it's in real time and it's available to us. But maybe for those who don't live in the data every day, kind of talk about where we are in terms of understanding how hard countries have been hit by COVID and whether you think, you know, we have kind of a consistent picture of that across the globe, or if there are particular kind of holes in our knowledge that you're most worried about.
Well, Jennifer, that's a great question. And, you know, it has been impressive to see the number of dashboards, reports. It's in some ways disconcerting because governments, the U.S. government, for example, and governments around the world didn't have that data infrastructure in place, didn't have reliable and consistent and timely data available to share with everyone in their country or in their state or around the world to be able to understand the risk and how it's spreading and changing. So what was remarkable, though, was to see the number of academic groups. Johns Hopkins set up an amazing database that allowed us to track the spread and consequences of this outbreak. The Pandemic Tracking Collective or set up an amazing scraping data off of public resources to be able to track the data as well. The COVID tracking team, I should call them, they've transitioned to the Pandemic Tracking Collective. But I mean, you saw a lot of academic efforts. You see a lot of private sector efforts. So we love seeing that innovation, and it was really helpful. At the same time, though, it did create, in some cases, a more fragmented approach to seeing data. Even today, as we look at data about Omicron in Denmark, there's dispute on, are we looking at the right metrics? Are we looking at cases instead of hospitalizations? Are we looking at people who are hospitalized with COVID or from COVID? And so you can almost grab almost any data set out there today, or a dashboard or report or newspaper, and find an answer for what you want or how you want to see that answer. So what it begs for is, number one, some alignment around the different types of data. It begs for a secure and standardized real-time national data platform, and maybe even a global data platform, where we have consistency in the types of data that we're looking at, consistency in the definition of data. Is it just hospitalized cases, or really do we need to nuance more carefully in hospitalized from or with COVID? And what difference that makes, because it does make a big difference. Are these vaccinated people or unvaccinated people in the hospital? And if they are vaccinated, how many doses have they received? Which vaccine did they get? I mean, there's so much information still missing, even though I think we're flooded with data around the world today in these different dashboards. There are still gaps. There are still dark spots around the world where we don't have hardly any data at all coming from places that are really hard to capture data or share data, where data privacy and sovereignty are taken to much higher standards in some cases. And really, to get in front of this pandemic and future pandemics, we need to have built a platform of trust and collaboration so we can turn on the lights around the world and really see what's happening. This is where the variants are percolating. This is where changes in the pathogenicity of the virus are changing. We need to be able to see this if we're going to really find a way to get in front of the virus and track it. So with all the great work, we still have a lot of work to bring it all together.
So you mentioned Denmark, and maybe for those who didn't see the sort of conversation that was unfolding about Denmark, which is that the country has decided to sort of end its public health emergency regarding COVID, lifting measures that had been previously put into place. It's notable that case numbers, the reported case numbers are increasing, hospitalizations also increasing, and many from the outside were looking at those numbers, suggesting that it indicates that, you know, perhaps the wrong policy course. Those more familiar with Denmark's situation will note that they are doing some of the most surveillance, some of the most testing, most in-depth analysis of COVID data of probably any country. And perhaps the interpretation wasn't quite as simplistic. But it raises a larger point, which is disincentives for data sharing. And it seems like, and you had referenced the travel bans, which I think many were quite appropriately outraged about, which is that we tend to penalize countries for being transparent, for doing the most to learn the most about these pathogens. And this seems like the response to those efforts is to somehow, you know, impugn their reputation about the approach, or to place sanctions on them. So given that, how do we reduce the data disincentives? I mean, is it purely a policy measure? Are there other things that we can do? How do we fix this? I could imagine countries look at this and say, like, why would I bother going to look around for this virus? It's only bad things will come to me.
You know, I heard that a lot. After the brave scientist, the astute scientist in South Africa, Dr. Tulio de Oliveiras and his team and his collaborators in Botswana and in other African countries, Southern African countries in particular, they worked really hard. They worked feverishly to make sure that the world had this information, this new variant of concern, as quickly as possible. We are close collaborators with the Siri Lab and Dr. De Oliveira, and I can attest that they didn't sleep. They worked hard to get this information and characterize it and validate it, make sure that they knew as much as they could before they went public to the South African Ministry of Health and to the WHO. Can imagine the incentive they felt to share this information with the world, and the data they were seeing, the information they were seeing from this new variant, as we've all seen now, how alarming it is. Then to very rapidly, almost instantaneously, be slapped with the punitive travel bans and without consideration the consequence that it would bring to the epicenter, we believe at the time, the epicenter, and where we needed more data sooner than anywhere else in the world, honestly. We needed to know more about this virus and how it was spreading. We needed to get public health measures in and tools and vaccines and drugs and diagnostics to try to contain it if we could. And that is the purpose of that early warning, is to try to get mitigation efforts in place to contain it so it doesn't spread. But it was a knee-jerk reaction that we also found very soon after that was unwarranted, because this virus had already spread. And it was that lack of data around the world, or lack of transparency of the data around the world, or just lack of the ability to keep up with the rapid flow of information and data of SARS-CoV-2, and the fear that I think led to these policies. I call it knee-jerk and panic-driven versus evidence-based. If we had these systems in place so we could get more data, we can learn that was already in parts of Europe, we can learn that was already in the United States and out there, that evidence-based approach could have, instead of punishing those countries in Southern Africa, could have flooded resources in that area to help them better contain and to better evaluate that. At the same time, by knowing that this variant of concern was already out of the bag, it was already spreading, and the rest of the world, instead of waiting to see if it would come, I would hope that we had learned our lesson through this pandemic, at least, that sitting back and waiting to see if it had come is foolhardy, because we know this airborne pathogen that is highly contagious and transmissible is coming, and it's most likely, if it's in a clinical specimen now in one part of the world, that's most likely already in the rest of the world as well. And so data and the lack of data and the lack of data transparency have been hurting our response to this pandemic. And Jennifer, I have to tell you, I've heard from many other countries across Africa and across the world who question now whether or not they should share data. I mean, you would think that this great example, the scientists in Southern Africa would say, yes, there's value in sharing data, but because of that knee-jerk reaction, they are very more hesitant than probably ever before of sharing data. So it's about getting data. It's about linking data to evidence-based policies and building that trust and transparency as a really high priority is the way we're going to incentivize countries to share information quickly so we can all get in front of this and future outbreaks.
Thank you. I mean, that's a really worrisome report that, you know, I mean, it's understandable given how hard countries have been hit when they do surface data, but it is really, really worrisome that we may be losing willingness to participate in this global surveillance endeavor. I know that you've been involved heavily, and I see a lot of questions queuing up, so I'm just going to take one more moderator's prerogative here, which is I know you've been heavily involved with genomic sequencing, and I was really interested to hear about the efforts to increase the representativeness of the sampling. That's always been something I've wondered about is how, what is the process to generate those data and what can we infer from those data based on, you know, what population are they reflective of? So I'm glad to hear about those efforts. Just maybe your thoughts on that, sort of where we are with respect to that globally, but also, you know, not just for tracking variants, but also where are we in terms of using genomic sequencing for epidemiology to better understand how the virus is spreading between people and what environment so that we can understand, you know, what are the drivers of transmission and how better to stop it, hopefully to enable us to kind of more pinpoint those rather than just kind of tell people to stay home for several years. How do we get there?
I'm going to have to build a farm out back, but to stay inside more years. But no, Jennifer, that's a really important question. Two really important questions you highlighted there. I mean, we're not doing enough genomic surveillance. There's so much valuable data within specimens to understand how the virus is changing, how it's evolving, how it's reacting to vaccines and drugs and how it works with diagnostics and how it's spreading. And unfortunately, it seems like when we ramp up our genomic surveillance in the US and around the world, it's always in those big, capable, big cities, big research centers or big public health labs or big academic centers around the world. And we get a lot of skewed information. You know, when we ramp up our genomic surveillance in the United States, we don't need millions and millions more sequences in New York City and LA. We need to know what's happening in middle America, where there really isn't as much genomic surveillance capabilities. We need to know what's happening in different communities and different populations so we can better understand how the virus is impacting people in different socioeconomic statuses in rural versus urban centers, people with different ethnic or genetic backgrounds as well. There's so much information that is important to know to better understand how a virus, especially something newly introduced into the human population, how it's affecting us, how it's changing. And if there are things that we think are working that are not, such as are vaccines working as well in every community, are different populations or people with immune compromised status or going through cancer therapy or others, or the virus changing differently, evolving at a different rate in those people or in those communities or populations. There's so much we need to know. And so trying to bring about greater representation of the sampling that we're doing across the US and across the world is really, really important to do. And therefore, to do that, we have to bring genomic surveillance capabilities to more places. It's not just in the very large research centers, but it really is through example, the partnership that we've supported at LSU and their partnership in bringing on Grambling University. We have several of those examples across the United States as well. And you're building that capability, you're opening the eyes in special populations and communities, and you're actually better preparing more places to be able to detect and respond to future outbreaks, not just SARS-CoV-2. Now, your second question is about epidemiology. What's really hard about that question, Jennifer, is the data from genomic surveillance are not connected to epidemiology. So data that we collect in epidemiology generally are siloed from genomic surveillance data. Genetic sequencing data is siloed. It's really hard to link it to clinical outcomes, to vaccinated or unvaccinated populations. The metadata are fragmented, disconnected in many ways. And so while we have lots of data, again, generated in the US and around the world, most of it is disconnected. It needs to be linked. We need to be able to see if particular genetic sequences or evolution of the virus is happening in vaccinated populations or unvaccinated or rural or urban, and more severe cases or less severe cases and many other examples. And one of the things that's really important to do is try to standardize these different data types, at least how they're reported, when they're reported, so we can connect them. We've also learned there are legal barriers to connecting data. There are HIPAA requirements in some cases. There are concerns about privacy. So it's important to acknowledge these concerns and these constraints, but also find ways to anonymize and de-identify data from different data sets so we can link them and bring the power of genomic surveillance into epidemiology, into vaccine and drug and diagnostic development.
Great. I'm going to call on folks that just appear in the order. My apologies in advance if I mispronounce your name, and please do correct my pronunciation and tell us what organization you're with. So the first one is Lyra Hughes Hale, if you want to come off mute and ask your question.
Yes, thank you. I'm Lyra Hale with EconView in Chicago. As you many of you probably know, I focus on China quite a bit. Isn't China the elephant in the room here? I do not foresee, and have you seen any willingness on the part of China to participate in this kind of effort, which I think is very laudable, but given security concerns over data in China, I don't see them ever participating. Can you prove me wrong with that? Have you seen any indications? And since the first pandemic began with China, and it's very likely that the next pandemic will begin with China, do you then need to create a strategy for data sharing ex-China? Thank you.
Thank you for your question. It's a really important question. I want to highlight a couple of good examples where China and scientists in China have been sharing data. I mean, it's important to acknowledge that the first information and genetic sequence data we had about this virus was shared from China in January of 2020. And because of their willingness to share that information is why we have vaccines today. And we've had them for a year, and why we have therapeutics and diagnostics. So that was a really important step forward for China to share that information. And I do acknowledge that there are challenges in privacy in different countries around the world. It's not just China, have challenges and different expectations on data sharing, data sovereignty, and of course, who and when they share that information with, who they share it with. And I think it's important that we do find ways to connect the world in different ways at the different levels, at the government level, at the institutional level, but also the scientific level, and new forms of communication and networking, so we can all have better signals of what might be happening in some part of the world. Even if we don't have data, there can be signals that something is happening that allows us then to come up with a hypothesis that warrants further investigation in a particular region. It could be a hypothesis. We could see data and signals of migration out of an area. We could see mobility and travel. We can see consumerism, purchase of different treatments or therapeutics, or different signs of ambulances and cars loading up and filling up in the hospital emergency room and driving driveways, et cetera. There's a number of things that we can parse together to give us good signals and hypotheses that something's happening, so we can then rely on scientific diplomacy and other means to try to get more information as soon as possible. I also want to highlight real quickly that throughout this pandemic, and maybe many people aren't aware of it, but China has been sharing a lot of genomic surveillance sequence information into the GISAID database. And so while it might appear that the government of China might be less communicative of different data sets or things happening in the country, scientists in China are sharing information. Scientists from over 191 countries and territories, many of those that have different types of governments and policies and rules and expectations around privacy and sovereignty, scientists are still working together. And those are the examples that we need to identify, we need to bolster, we need to support, because it is trust among the scientific community that I believe can serve as greater scientific diplomacy to bring more nations together in the future. But I'm not mesmerized or have some fantasy that every country around the world is going to somehow be best friends and join hands and always work together. We've seen that highlighted in the most disastrous way in this pandemic, and many countries failed the test. And I do hope, though, that in context of that realization, that we will find a way for scientific diplomacy and scientists to share. And that trust is what will better prepare us for the next pandemic.
Thank you for that. And I just have to point out that the last global pandemic was in 2009, and it was first recognized in the United States. So I'm going to turn now to Jay Markowitz. Jay, do you want to come off and ask your question?
Yeah, thanks. Hi, it's Jay Markowitz at Arch Venture Partners. Thanks to both of you for doing this call, and more importantly, for all you've done and continue to do. Rick, you know, nobody could argue with your premise about the importance of having data. But even if we had perfect data about the present, we're dealing with complex dynamic systems. So whether it's a pandemic, whether it's weather, whether it's the situation right now in the Ukraine, we could all agree on the data, but we're then trying to figure out the future from the present. So could you please explain where you see the greatest potential of using the data that we currently have, and what are the limitations on using data to predict the future, given that that's where some of the, you know, that's where the uncertainty and the difficulty lies? Thank you.
Jay, thank you for your question. And I absolutely agree with you that it's not for lack of data. I think the world is saturated in data. And you can, like, as I said earlier, you can look and find whatever data you want out there. But there are a number of these constraints and challenges that are preventing us from having the right data or the right data sets and allowing us to combine the right data to get a better picture of what might be emerging and what we need to do about it and when. I think there's maybe four or five critical constraints that are hindering an effective public response to things such as outbreaks. I think one of them, I think the first one is that there's just a lack of a standardized real-time national data platform to share data across from SARS-CoV-2 and other health threats. I think there's also significant variations in data quality and the sources of data from both public and private entities. This is all over the place. It's really difficult to combine it because it's sporadic and it's random in many cases. The third thing, I think that the linkages that I talked to Jennifer about a minute ago, it's siloed. Again, there's beautiful data, but if we just had a way to connect some of it, we would have much better insights. If we can connect vaccination with clinical outcomes in terms of the type of vaccine, or is it vaccine breakthrough, and there's so much. If we just knew how many people were vaccinated in our country, and if they had one dose or two dose or a booster dose, and if we could then track and monitor and use that data with genomic surveillance and other things, we would have a better insight on the effectiveness of our vaccines and know if we need to update them or when we need to update them. I think a fourth thing is the timing of when we get the data. So even if we had linkages and we had more standardization of how the data are, it's just coming too late. It's going through too much red tape, too much bureaucracy in many ways. And so the reporting and the timing comes out in a varied way. You know, we track influenza outbreaks and always 3 weeks in the rearview mirror, or sometimes more, sometimes 3 months in the rearview mirror. So how would we ever get in front of an emerging influenza pandemic or a seasonal change within a season of influenza virus if we're only looking at data 3 months in arrears? And finally, I think the analysis of the data are limited and they're not transparent and they're delayed as well. I mean, we are using outdated methodologies and how we look at data. I mean, I have seen global entities making one of the most important decisions in the world each year, one might argue, and how to put the right formulation into an influenza vaccine composition to be able to save lives from influenza in the upcoming season. And some of those data are in spreadsheets in Excel spreadsheets with a ruler that are gone through in three ring binders, a number of three ring binders every year. You can't convince me that we can't do better if we modernize how data are collected, how they're stored, and bring together some modern analytics, some AI, some additional ways of looking at as artificial intelligence and other ways of looking at data to come up with a better insight. You can't convince me that we cannot make a better influenza vaccine or better SARS-CoV-2 vaccine by not bringing together all the data we have with modern analytics and artificial intelligence and coming up with a predictive design and composition for an antigen that will be much more effective at blocking future variants of influenza or SARS-CoV-2. It's all out there, but we need to bring together these tools. We need to standardize, we need to link it, and we need to coordinate in some magical way. And then I think we'll have the most power that we can use to stop future pandemics.
Great, thank you. Roy Pettis.
Hi, I'm Roy Pettis. I'm the National Intelligence Fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations this year. And I must admit that a lot of these problems always seem very analogous to my struggles with getting the right data together and trying to tie them to a policymaker's decision. But I always hope that I'm a physicist by training, and I always hope in things with harder scientific data, it would be more obvious that people could trust the data. But actually, what I want to ask about is sort of a historical analogy. I'm very aware that the 1918 pandemic created surges in public health understanding and efforts by the, particularly this country, but other but nations of the world, to do better in the future. And then it all kind of fell apart in 1923. People began to, the government stopped funding a lot of it, and people began to not work on maintaining those capabilities. What can we do to ensure that we don't, that we keep the priorities here to ensure that there really is a data-driven basis for future mitigation, which I think we're going to have to deal with.
Right. Thank you for that question. And I couldn't agree with you more. Once again, we've seen in past outbreaks, it was in 1918, but I mean, you don't have to go back that far to see how we responded to the Ebola, to SARS, to MERS, to Zika, and others. We panic during those crises. We flood it with money and we want immediate answers. The crisis wanes, the pathogen wanes or becomes more manageable. The funding dries up. The infrastructure put in place to respond to the crisis shuts down. The private sector that came to the fight with the resources from the government go back to other profitable, much more profitable enterprises and targets and priorities. And we let the well run dry. And then the next crisis comes our way and we're scrambling to rebuild it from scratch once again. And so we've seen that repeatedly. I mean, that is history, as you carefully mentioned. I believe that we have to do, I mean, yeah, so here's my altruistic hope and vision, idealistic world in mind. I mean, this is real. This is the worst thing that we've faced in the world in our lifetimes. And I would hope that seeing the benefit that we've seen now from having the public sector and private sector work more closely together to identify innovations and tools and solutions to this outbreak, not just in the data world, but also in the stock supply chain world and the raw materials and so many things that have become so painfully apparent, even though we've seen them in the past, I would hope would be the motivation and incentive for ongoing sustained funding, not just from the United States government in a supplemental or a special appropriations act. Again, we've seen those money come and they've seen those money dry up. You know, I begged for, and begged is the right word. I begged for nearly a decade in government while I was working in BARDA, the Biomedical Advanced Research and Development Authority. 4 years as the director, I took my slide deck up and down Capitol Hill to funders and appropriators and committees, begging for money to be better prepared for a pandemic, to have better surveillance systems in place, better data infrastructure and architecture, better platform capabilities for vaccines and diagnostics and therapeutics, and better enabling technologies to deliver those and administer those vaccines and drugs. And I was, and the US was unsuccessful in raising money. And you know, the boy that cried wolf was mentioned to me too many times. I'm hoping now that Congress, the global funding organizations, the G20, the G7, a number of international opportunities, the private sector, the philanthropy sector, all see now that we have a moment in time, once again, with a shared experience to combine and collaborate and sustain an effective model for an early warning signal, for surveillance, for the platforms for drugs and vaccines and diagnostics. We have to find a way to sustain them, to keep them warm, to exercise them, and to be able to trigger them at the right nuanced level when they're needed, or we will find ourselves back in the same 2020 situation again next time another virus or bacteria or fungi raises its head. And it's going to happen. It's happening more and more frequently. And so I'm hoping that someone out there is hearing us this time. I'm not begging. I'm telling you now with data that we have to do something different.
I completely agree. One of my biggest fears is that we've sort of couched this in the 1918 terms, and that makes us feel like we've bought ourselves 99 years not to worry about this, as opposed to the fact that we're living in an era where these threats are going to continue to occur. And just like we, you know, ready our societies for storms and fires, we have to think about pandemics that way. Emmanuel de Harcourt, do you want to come off and ask your question?
Hi, yes, thank you very much to both of you. This is really interesting. My question sort of builds on what a couple of people have already asked, but in terms of the gap between intention and reality, because I mean, the list you put forth at the beginning makes, you know, a lot of sense. And even talking about the travel ban that Jennifer asked about, it seems that there's such a gap between what public health scientists know is, you know, not even a particularly difficult question, and what actually gets done politically. I won't have the indelicacy of asking you what to do if you face a hostile government, because you've demonstrated that by your actions. But it seems that even with more science-friendly governments, such as the one we have now, for example, in terms of vaccine equity, you know, forgetting charity, but just in terms of sheer public health self-interest, there was a gap between what well-informed, well-meaning people were doing and what we knew was the right thing. So I was just curious to hear your insights on how to address that. I'm sure you've thought about that quite a lot.
Thank you, Emmanuel. You're exactly right. I mean, there is a gap. There will always be a gap, I think, in data and political response. I mean, I've learned the hard way how pandemics are not just about the science, not just about the people, not just about the economy, but it's also about the politics. And you know, many of the exercises that we've all played in war games we've played, each of us through the last decades, have, you know, talked about money, talked about response, talked about data. We never factored in a hostile government, a government politicizing an outbreak, a public health crisis in such a disastrous way. Of course, now we know to always include that in our scenarios. But I believe that one way to augment that political response is to make the data that we have available. I mean, the innovation that we've seen over the last 2 years in terms of data that we is generated and how we analyze data and how we can connect data. I mean, it's ripe now. The opportunity now is to start connecting that to evidence-based policies. It's remarkable to understand how many policies and public health mitigation actions and activities we have in place that aren't really yet supported or linked to data, but they sounded good. And they came out of a lot of these exercises and war games that we played in the past. And they've been bolstered by limited information, but mostly by ideological alignment in some cases. Now we have data. So it's time to connect those data to those policy discussions so we can have evidence-based policies. At the same time, I believe there is power in empowering more people at different levels with the data and knowledge. I mean, in this pandemic, I think many of us in this country believed it was solely up to the government to protect us, to give us that information or to provide the guidance that we needed to protect ourselves. While that is an important role of government and politics, we've learned now that that's not always going to be the case. It's not always going to be accurate or clear or timely. And so as we now have new powerful tools and data and ways to analyze data, I think another challenge for us as experts is to find ways to translate those data into action so more individuals can understand their risk and know what to do to reduce the risk. Instead of waiting for the government to always give us the answer or the solution, if we can break this powerful data down into community response, into individual response tools, then we'll have more people at more levels helping to ebb that tide or bend that curve or whatever you want to call it, but playing a larger role in a public response to a pandemic, even while we're waiting for governments to align their ducks, get money together, and determine what is the most effective or best information to share with their population or the citizenship. I think it is, I'm pretty sure, actually, the power of data, translating it to more people, will change and transform a public health response in the future, where we're not just relying on governments.
Thank you. I'm going to see if we can squeeze in one more quick question. Patricia Rosenfields, if you could ask quickly.
Thank you very much, Jennifer. And thank you to the two of you, as others have said, for what you've done and for the wisdom that underlies this conversation, which I hope we'll have many more of. I'm Patricia Rosenfield. I come from the Rockefeller Archive Center, but also was at Carnegie Corporation for years and the World Health Organization in the Tropical Disease Research Program as an economist. So what I wanted to ask you was going back to bringing history forward for today, and we don't have to go back as far as 1918 to see that the Rockefeller Foundation actually had in place, I would say, one of the most important pandemic prevention programs through the training of epidemiologists all over the world. So my question is, what you're talking about, and I fully support, Dr. Bright, the importance of local level collaboration and responses, the scientific community and playing a really important connecting role to change policies and provide data. but you need the expertise in the scientific community and the, and as Jennifer was saying, the epidemiological community to understand social sciences, genomics. And that's what INCLN did. The International Clinical Epidemiology Network trained and brought together scientists from all over the world, developing countries, developed countries, rural areas, urban areas. So where is the capacity building efforts to help prevent the pandemic of the future that have that interdisciplinary training and those connections? And then some of them go into government and become wiser policymakers. So how is that going to happen?
And okay, it so we have that. 4 minutes, just maybe a quick word on capacity building.
Patricia, thanks for bringing that up because that's really important. I mean, it's not about, again, all the knowledge being held in a few hands. It really is about building that local knowledge economy, that capability at the local level and local ownership of those data. And so one of the examples, the Stellenbosch University in Surrey in South Africa, Rockefeller Foundation, because of this history that you've identified and highlighted, instead of just dropping in sequencing equipment and instruments in different places and say, go for it, sequence and share. And we really are investing in Dr. Tulio de Oliveiras and his team. They've trained over 100 scientists from 9 different countries across Africa now. The plan is to train more scientists from more countries across Africa, expand that into Southeast Asia and the Latin America and South America. We have to train the scientists on how to not just generate data, but how to analyze their data and put it in that local context so they can make local decisions. But we have to also give them this platform to connect those data globally so they can have a global context, so we can all have a global context of an outbreak as it emerges and spreads. But it starts with that local capacity, and not just capacity, but local capability to understand and analyze and to be able to translate locally action that they can do to trigger a response that will help contain and protect their communities.
Rick, thank you so much for spending time with us today, but for your continued service and making sure the world is a safer and healthier place. I really appreciate that you're continuing to show us how the data can set us free, and that is really the path to sounder decision-making. And so I just really am grateful that you are willing to continue to serve in this role and to share your insights with us, and very much appreciate it.
Thank you, Jennifer. It's my pleasure. Thanks again to the council for the great questions and discussion today. I appreciate it.